Hello, everybody. Welcome to Vaginal Fantasy. This is a book club where me and my awesome three co-hosts for 55 episodes, as of today, we discuss some romance novels, mostly of the genre persuasion, such as, fantasy, horror, urban fantasy, sci-fi, last month, and this month, a Regency romance or historical romance, which is, you know, that's a top spin. And joining me to discuss our book of the month, which you can further explore on goodreads.com/vaginalfantasy, we have Kyla Casby.
Hey, sup?
You look out of control drunk with baby things behind you.
That's what I am. That's who I am.
Okay. I mean, that's fair. It's the primary right colors. Kind of go with the primary colors of whatever. What are you drinking?
Oh, I'm just a little bit of Sinfire and some like a vodka seltzer thing.
I see a mason jar.
Oh, yeah. I'm totally double. There wasn't a lot of Sinfire left, so it's.
Wow.
Look, being a mom is fucking hard. Okay. I made it through the day.
Okay.
And I've only
congratulations.
Got like, I've got like three pieces of goldfish crackers stuck to me. And that's, I feel like that's a win.
It's a win.
That is a win. And next to her, at least in my world, is Bonnie Burton.
Hey, how's it going? I don't have any kids. I have a dog that's off to the left playing with her snack toy, that Kong thing, for those dog people out there that know what I'm talking about. You stuff the treats in it. So she's, if you hear a dull thud and then some weird sounds, that's her. It's not.
It's like, not something else that's in your apartment.
I did not cumber kidnap anybody.
Well, but you do have them around your neck. Can you just
show
off a little bit of, tell us what you're drinking and then show off your awesome necklace. And I am very jealous of your sweater, A, because it's 90 degrees here, so I can't wear a sweater yet. B, I just love it.
Okay, well, first of all, the sweater is, I got it because I'm stalking Lucy Liu on Elementary and everything she wears. And I found a website that shows like what she's wearing. And it's kind of like this nice little, it's a huge cardigan, but it's got like a skull at the back of it.
Yeah.
You know, if you can see. And then I've got a Benedict Cumberbatch Sherlock cameo that I believe was either an Etsy purchase or a convention purchase.
Very cute.
In
very
honor,
I love cameos. So
in honor of really in honor of him being on the cover of Vanity Fair and complaining about his internet fans, so I had to wear it.
What did he say about his internet fans?
Okay, oh. So you know how I've brought up a few times that I think his marriage might be more publicity than romance.
Which, based in what?
Based on the fact that they were only dating, like, barely before they got engaged, and she was already pregnant, and...
Well, maybe that's why they got engaged.
I don't know. Yeah, I've dissected that that Wimbledon date video that was, like, their date before they got... I don't know. Anyway, I'm obsessed, and of course he called it out in... He didn't call out my name, but he did say that...
Damn it.
He did say that he did tweet. There was a mention of Joseph Scrimshaw's tweet about if you want to feel better about your day, just imagine Cumberbatch shirtless and eating an apple fritter. So they told him that tweet. I wish I had thought of that tweet.
He's not the kind of guy I would ever imagine shirtless. You know what I'm saying? Like, guys like Joe Mangiolano, whatever his name is. That's, I'm like, okay.
Mangianiello.
That guy.
I will say, you can see shirtless Cumberbatch in the Doctor Strange trailer, and it's pretty good. So I'm just saying. But anyway, he said he's tired of being the internet's boyfriend, and that his...
Well, boo-hoo!
If he stopped being the internet's boyfriend, can you imagine how sad he'd be?
I know.
If someone like got like bigger than him, he'd be like,
honestly, after binge watching Luke Cage, I'm pretty sure that Mike Coulter is now my new Cumberbatch. So I went from a whole extreme to another extreme, and I'm not even talking race. I'm talking build, like bodybuilder. Like that guy could like. I don't even think he needs Luke Cage powers to bend guns. I think he just did that in real life.
Yeah.
In the TV show Luke Cage. But anyway, I digress. I am drinking bourbon a lot. There's water in here.
I thought that was iced tea, so I'm concerned.
No, it's bullet bourbon with some water because I'm trying to like bourbon. I'm not drinking it fast. The straw is just because I don't like the feel of bourbon on my teeth. I know it's weird.
What? I love it.
And then I also have some Starbucks and Bailey's.
You guys are like, I'm drinking water, so you guys are making up for me drinking water because I'm so tired. I just can't deal with
it. Well, a coffee is to keep me up because I have a bunch of writing deadlines later.
Okay. All right. So let's talk to Veronica. Veronica.
Yay!
And our last but not least, never least, Veronica Belmont with the adorable haircut. Did you have that haircut last month?
Yes.
I still think it's the perfect length for
but
you.
But you haven't seen the shave.
Oh, you
what? Not the shave. You got the
flash. Wait, show it off.
Can you see?
I'm going to click on it. I hope people can see this. Oh, my God.
So I shaved the whole back of my head. Not the whole back, just the short part. But yes, my room, everybody's like, ooh, her room's all yellow. Yeah, the lighting in here is a little yellow. I'm sorry. I'm not jaundiced. It's just how the light looks.
How does your hair look so full and thick, and yet you got rid of some of it?
You know, I don't know. I really was like worried that my hair would look like I didn't have any hair, but my hair was already so fine.
I have really thin hair. Yeah.
It just kind of really looks the same from the front.
I bet it poofs it out a little bit. I remember when I had like a like an undercut, you know, kind of stacked bob, you know, like in the 1920s. You know, look, there's a painting in the basement. It's not important. So and it made my hair. I know I have a lot of hair, although I've lost a shit ton of hair. So,
oh really?
I'm so happy about it. But it made my hair go like, you know, because there was some shaving back here a little bit, you know, hairline and everything. It made it all kind of poofier, and it definitely gave you a little more oomph.
Yeah, it's not really doing that. It's very flat in the back. It just looks
adorable.
The same. Thank
it
you.
Looks the same.
Yeah. Need to remember to comb my hair, but next time I'm going to wash my hair and comb it before Vaginal Fantasy, okay? My vow to you.
I washed my hair yesterday for the first time. I took a bath for the first time in like a week.
You're a mess, Kyla, but okay. But guys,
drinking whiskey. I'm drinking, first okay. I was drinking a nice Japanese whiskey, and now I'm drinking just cheap whiskey.
I do want to show off my earrings that my dad got me because he went to Paris or London. And my favorite jewelry store in the world is this place called, it's French, so I'm going to butcher it. It's Les Nereides. Wait, come on. What is the name of it?
Les Nereides.
That's backwards. Les Nereides. N-E-R-E-I-D-E-S. It's impronounceable.
Les Nereides.
So anyway, they have the cutest jewelry in the world, you guys. And I just found out they have a Chicago store and they might be opening an LA store, which is going to be bad for my bank account. But they have like, it's like fancy costume jewelry with animals a lot of the time and flowers. And I have a fox with a top hat and they're so cute. It's the best. So anyway, my dad sent me these earrings and it's their little kitten holding a gem. So shout out to that.
Can I say one thing?
Yes.
Okay,
two things. One, I'm disappointed, Veronica, that you didn't shave my initials into the back of your head.
I had shapes, cool shapes in my hair, but my hair grows so fast that it didn't make sense to keep trying to shave designs into my head. It was so very
expensive. Okay, that does make sense. Yeah. But also, I'd like to say that, you know, we have it's a smallish kind of living room, you know, in our house. Mm-hmm. And we never thought that we would be able to fit a piano in here.
I know, it's really
It's really nice. You can have a cabaret in your own house.
And I feel like, isn't there like room for a tiny martini on the side?
Oh God, absolutely.
Tiny
thing. I'm so proud of us.
I do have to say one thing in response to Kyla, and that is her fiance obviously loves her more than my husband loves me because he left the room to stop watching the Giants game so Kyla could do Vaginal Fantasy. And my husband would never do that.
Wow.
I would never do that for my husband. So
I'm sorry. You're missing a game right now.
It is the do or die wild card game versus the Mets tonight. So if the Giants lose, we're out of the postseason, and you know we made a good run of it. But if we go on, it'll be great. It's stressful. So we will see. I'm really trying not to. I just got pop ups on my phone, so don't, I'm just really okay. trying not
well,
to look at those.
So go ahead and look at the score, Veronica. While I do shout outs. So we're gonna get into our book discussion, but first, I always do a shout out to all the local meetups that we have around the world for local vaginal fantasy men and women getting together and discussing the book of the month, the alt book, and any books they have to discuss in their lives. So I just want to spread word about these awesome local things and give a shout out to anybody who met this month in September. On August 31st, the Oakland Ooh La La's met. I believe that's a new group, and it's a Google Plus Hangout. On September 1st, we had the Vaginistas in a Google Hangout as well. Wanton Wisconsinites met in Milwaukee. The Yearning Yinzers met in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Cloudy with a Chance of Quitlet, which I can never say.
My favorite.
Met in Seattle, Washington. You guys definitely win. Ladies of the Great Lakes met in Birmingham, Michigan at the Mad Hatter Bistro. I think that's a new one too. Cleft of the Shadow, the WoW Guild. It is, they met for Brewfest. So that's pretty cool, guys. If you want to, I hear Legion is amazing. So if you want to get back into WoW, there's an awesome group of people online through our group that are playing on WoW. So look into it. The Reverse Cowgirls met in Austin, Texas. Beers, I think they're one of our oldest groups, actually. The Beers, Books, and Boobs have met in Holly, Michigan. We have a couple of Michigan people. They went to the Renaissance Fair, you guys.
Oh, I love Renaissance Fairs.
Me too. Joey. Me too. Only Lefters Left in the Library met in Google Hangout from Puerto Rico. The Central European Tarts met in Europe on a Google Hangout. Cleft of the Shadow, they're doing like weekly meetups, you guys. So get them WoW. Do that kind of thing. Literary Ladies of the Night met in a Google Hangout through California. The Venus Flytraps met in Dayton, Ohio. The Viking Booties met in Sweden, also one of our old school groups. The Vaginistas, another old school group, met in a Google Hangout. And the Ambassadors of Smut met are meeting on November 4th in Orange County, California. And the Wanton Wisconsinites are meeting next week in Milwaukee somewhere. So if you want to join any of those groups, go to the local groups tab in our folders at goodreads.com/vaginalfantasy. If you want to create your own group locally and there's nothing active in your area, do it. Or just create a little Google Hangout. Obviously, we have some awesome things going on in the community. And, you know, we're a small community, but it's like we've been doing this for 4 years and a lot of people are stuck around. So
can I also add in something?
Yes, add in something.
If you guys have a Google Hangout that's a video that's on YouTube, be sure to tag us so we can see it, because I love watching other other vaginal fantasy subgroups do their own.
We should create meetups. A playlist. Bonnie, we should create a playlist of other people's hangouts, and then we can just do local hangouts on our page.
Yeah. Okay. I'll do that. I'll work with our fabulous Jackie on that. But yeah, that's something that like I try to keep an eye on YouTube, mm-hmm. and I love watching other people's hangouts because they go on tangents like we do. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of heavy drinking, a lot of giggling. And they actually bring up a lot of stuff that I don't even think about when I'm reading the book. So it's kind of fun to watch either before or after our own like Google Hangout. So, but I'll start a list, and I'll also start putting that on our social media so people can check
it
out.
Yeah, that'd be great. That'd be great.
Also, I just want to say that WoW group is my friend Melissa's.
Oh,
and she is one of the people who, you know, like just got me through pregnancy and everything. And she's amazing and funny. And she's on Twitter, whatever, as Pygmy Warrior. So she's amazing. So
cool.
Yay. Well, I love the fact that if I had more time, I would be in there. I'm exhausted because I was shooting all week and I have a deadline. And that's why I'm drinking water.
Shooting? Were you shooting librarians?
No, I was shooting Mystery Science Theater.
Okay. Yes.
Can't say anything about it. You guys are gonna love it, though. It's so funny.
Yay! Well, I'm covering Mystery Science Theater. I'm covering it for CNET, so
I don't know when it's out, but it's gonna be on Netflix, which I'm so thrilled about. Hey, another shout out to our moderator Sean Sandaluki Luke. He He is awesome. He keeps our forums clean. It's cleaner than it's ever been. And he has a book called The Zookeeper's Dilemma, which you can pre-order on Inkshares, and it's a vaginal fantasy book. And all of us make cameos in it as ourselves, although we don't have sex in them, just to be – it is his book. And if you want to support and check out one of our group members' foray into literature, hopefully smutty. If not, it's probably still good. Check it out. It's The Zookeeper's Dilemma on Inkshares.com. It's a really good platform. My friend is releasing a book called Dracula versus Hitler there.
I have that book. Yeah. It's awesome.
Dracula on the way to me.
Yeah. I get all the Inkshare books to review and stuff. And man, that's a good book.
Did you review it? Oh my God. I'm so happy. Yeah. Mainstream publishers were not into it. And I was like, this is an amazing book. So I really hope that it becomes really big on its own.
What was the other Dracula? There was another Dracula book on there. On Inkshares too, it was like
Sword and Laser had an unattractive vampire unbelievably great.
That was good too.
Yeah, there's some really good books on there, and yeah. they act like a real publisher, so they're very choosy about the things they do, and they really support the book. So, and the cover of Dracula vs. Hitler is pretty awesome. So if you guys can pick it up, you will definitely enjoy it. Okay, let's get into our book, you guys.
Wait,
what?
Sorry. Can I just real quick tell a Mr. Science Theater thing? Really
yeah.
Quick? Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So bad.
I'll keep this real short.
You were in Al Qaeda?
When I was in ISIS.
What's going on?
I'm tremendous. When I was in San Francisco, I came up here to Portland to visit friends and stuff for a bachelorette party. We went to karaoke and then to a strip club, and I was in the bathroom and some girl came up and was like, "Oh, your hair's so pretty," and I fell for it. And then next thing I knew, you know, my wallet was gone. So the next day,
that's a thing.
Yeah, it happened, and I was, you know, like sobbing and just very upset, and all the strippers were like dancers were consoling me, and
artists,
it was really very sweet. Yes. So then I, you know, I got back into my hotel room after some whole crap that had to happen. But the next morning I had to call and make a, you know, like call the police and make a thing. And report it. And the guy was like, "So, you know, what's gone from your wallet?" And I told him all the stuff that's gone from my wallet. And he's like, "Anything else, you know, like important?" And I said, "Well, yes. My Mystery Science Theater card. I've had it since I was 17, and I laminated it myself." And he's like, "You laminated it yourself?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "That's adorable."
That's really cute.
And he's like, "You put it in the." He's like, "I'm putting that in the report." It is the thing that I mean. That was the only irreplaceable thing that was in my wallet, and it's gone. I mean, I'm really very upset. I was one of like the first few thousand. It was.
Ryan also. Ryan was also part of the fan club.
And I believe
he also had a
card.
That's
hilarious.
Did he get like the, because we think it's like the Tom Servo rolling action figure. Like,
yeah, he was obsessed.
Yeah, you put it on like a marble. And
I had no idea. I mean, I'm a huge fan. I can't say anything about it other than if you're a fan of the show, you will love the new one because it's so, Joel is behind everything and it's just like the old show.
Joel is my favorite. I don't want to be a jerk, but he's my fave.
He's kind of awesome, you guys. Don't mean to drop it. Anyway, okay, let's get into our show. Go. I know.
Hold on.
Our book was very fast. It was a very light, fast read, so it's fine that we have less time to talk about it because it was a light, fast read. And Bonnie has the cover here, so I'm going to read the description and talk about it a little bit.
Gonna click on her.
I got her.
You got her. Okay.
Romancing the Duke by Duke. Oh boy. Romancing the Duke by Tessa Dare. As the daughter of a famed author, Isolde Ophelia Goodnight grew up on the tales of brave knights and fair maidens. She never doubted romance would be in her future too. The storybooks offered endless possibilities. As she grew older, Izzy counted them off one by one by one. Ugly ducklings turn a swan, abducted by handsome highwaymen, rescued from drudgery by charming prince. Nope, nope, and heh. Now Izzy's given up yearning for romance. She'll settle for a roof over her head. What fairy tales are left over for an impoverished 26-year-old woman who's never been kissed? This one. Prepare to fall in love. The Romancing the Duke. Now, I picked, this was my month's pick, and I love Regency romance, even though it's completely chauvinist and terrible in a lot of ways. But it, but some of them break a mold enough that they are very, very fun. And this is one of them. I got this book because I went by the Ripped Bodice. And the Ripped Bodice, mm-hmm. you can order things online, but it's a local, it's in Los Angeles. It's a romance bookstore opened by two sisters who did a Kickstarter. And they have an amazing selection of romance books of all type, genre romance, regulars. And you go in there and they recommend amazing books. I think that our next month book also is recommended by them through Bonnie.
Yep.
So I ask her, hey, I want to do a Regency romance. Do you have any suggestions? And her eyes lit up so loud and bright for this book. And I was like, she was like,
do I?
It's going to sound cheesy, but it's kind of about cosplayers. And I was like, wait, what? And I was like, all right, it sounds fun. It sounds like people would like it. So that's how I picked this book.
Did you go, what? Like that? That's how what I imagined you did.
What?
Oh my God. Guys, the animated GIFs on this one episode alone is gonna like be enough to keep us all amused for months.
Wow. That's the best. I want that Veronica GIF every
yeah,
day.
Yeah, do it again, Veronica. Do
okay,
it again.
Hold on. I have to get the mic out of the way.
All right, get it, and then I'm going to click on you. All right.
Ready?
What?
I want to do it.
Wow.
First
all right, you do it. Best. You do it, Kyla.
Okay, here we go. Wait, let me click on.
All right, here we go. What?
You gotta shake your head.
Oh, you gotta shake. Oh.
And look into the camera. You gotta look in the camera. Okay, take two.
Okay. What?
You're not shaking your jowls. You gotta shake your jowls. Like a walus. Like channel a walus. Yeah.
That makes it on my chins. Then they shake. I don't like it.
All right. Bonnie, do you want to do one?
Oh, yeah. Okay, I can do one. Okay, let's see if I can do it. Okay, ready? Okay.
What? Oh man, now it's not even close.
I don't know. Let me try.
What? That was better.
Oh, that was good.
No, I feel like you guys aren't getting into the physical comedy of it enough. You're not
have the best hair for it. It's the shaved hair. You've got a lot of movement.
I feel like you do this a lot.
Maybe. That might be
I feel like you have a lot more practice. Though I will say that whenever I hear the record scratch on movie trailers, I wonder if there's all those millennials that aren't into vinyl or like, what's that noise?
Right? I don't know. They're totally into they're totally into
do
vinyl.
Do they get it? They get the record scratch, right? Because sometimes there's no records unless they go to Urban Outfitters. And
No, because they're only buying records.
Right, next month I'll have my hair down and I'll do another one because I think the hair really 100% makes it.
The hair really adds to it. By the way, I wanted to say, since I read the hardcovers and not Kindle, thank you for picking a book that had senior font. Look how huge this is. I was like, oh my God, I don't even need my glasses. I could just read this in the bathtub and not have to worry about, because I can't read in the bathtub because the glasses steam up. So I was like, this is great. This is like, I cannot wait till I get even older. And it's just like 5 words a page.
Have you ever seen those really big fonts? I mean, it's that's the good thing about the Kindle. You don't have to be like, I'm going to go to the big font section. That's the only good. That's like definitely where.
Every time Twitter does some sort of update where you have like a whole overhaul, the first thing I do is go into settings of my phone and just hit +++ on font. Because I can't read anything anymore. So.
Oh, no.
I know.
I can't because a tiny dictator is taking away every electronics I have in my hand.
So you mean a very short dictator that looks like a tiny Mussolini?
Yes. And so I he looks very Aryan. I just want to say that. for two dark-haired people that just look very like Eastern European, I don't understand where he came from. I think it's family. But the point is that he does do that, and so I have to get all my books, like the physical books from now on, because I can't read them if he's around.
Yeah. So anyway, thank you. Motherhood.
Now, Bonnie, why don't you go first? Tell you what you thought of this book, Romancing the Duke.
I liked it. I don't normally like books where the main characters are virgin. I kind of find that annoying just because I found virgins annoying when I was a virgin, and I still kind of find them annoying. Like, I feel bad for them because they think of sex as this, like, magical thing that's going to happen. It's like, I mean, it is if you both love each other and maybe it's, like, all this sexual tension for years and then something happens in a waterfall. I don't know. But for most of us, losing our virginity is not fun. It's painful. It's embarrassing. Things get caught and snagged. There's not, it's not this, like, ooh, like, you know, there's not unicorns standing by.
Well, there's a lot of, like, tension because everyone builds up this, oh, don't lose it, or you're impure, or you're or you're not valuable anymore. It's this awful societal thing that really, it's like, whoa, that was a lot of to-do we didn't need to worry about.
Well, growing up in the 80s, for me, it was everyone just wanted to get rid of their virginity. Like, it wasn't like this great blossoming bullshit thing. It was like, oh my God, I can't wait till I have sex just to get it over with. Just to get that one thing over with, and then I can enjoy myself, because that first time, it's like, no, that's not fun. So anyway, reading a book where the lead is a virgin always irritates me, but
especially she was 26.
Yeah, well, I don't judge. I don't judge, because, you know,
I judge that.
Well, it was a different time.
It was a different time.
It wasn't like 80s mall.
She kind of missed her married window for the time. So it was like, if you didn't get married by then,
by like 18, not good you're for just you. Too old.
I would judge now.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I don't really judge now either. But anyway, my judginess wasn't really with this book as I thought it was going to be, because she didn't treat it as annoyingly as many other virgin books do. Mm-hmm. In fact, she seemed very sexually adventurous and excited, and it wasn't like this secret. It wasn't like a secret diary type. I don't know. It wasn't precious. I mean, it was, but it wasn't. You know what I mean? It wasn't overly precious. So I liked that. I really loved the characters. Loved Ransom. Even though I know an author named Ransom Riggs, I kept picturing him, and that was just the wrong guy to picture.
No.
But, I mean, he's a good-looking guy, but he's, like, you know, skinny author dude. And this, I tried to picture more Fassbender-esque. But anyway, I really liked Ransom. I liked the side characters. I liked that the girls weren't fighting over guys. Like, I liked that it wasn't like, hey, you're a girl, you're instantly my enemy. Like, always happens in all romance books. It was, hey, let's be friends. Like, it was, I liked that. So there was, it was a fun, lighthearted read. I liked the whole LARPer thing. I liked the idea that her dad was an author. I like the idea of fandom in a book, which is something new that we hadn't really come across yet, I don't think. And it was just an interesting read. I had a lot of fun reading it. And I honestly don't like, I mean, nothing against Regency type books, but for me, I have to add in a werewolf or a vampire or an alien or a ghost, or else I don't care about the book. And I really liked this book a lot. It was a good pick, Felicia. Well done. Bravo.
Thank you. Someone in the comments just did say that later in life, virgins should not be shamed. And I totally empathize with that. And I was, that was not cool on my part.
Well, no, I mean,
and also,
and mine too. I said it too. Mine too.
Well, here's the thing. Virgins have a weird stigma. And I have friends that are asexual, and that's totally cool. And I've almost kind of become asexual because I don't date really. And I don't go out and pick up people. And also,
why you don't identify as asexual?
Kind of. It's more like I'm not really identifying as asexual. I'm just lazy. And I think there's a big difference between
big difference.
You
know? Yeah, it's a big difference.
Like, it's not that I'm against, it's not that sex isn't interesting to me, it's just no one is interesting enough to have sex with. So
I think especially in romance books, I think it's sort of a weird way to rationalize the likability of a character. And I think that sometimes that can be portrayed as pejorative or like shaming of women who embrace their sexuality in this specific genre. Because it is kind of a trope of the genre that sometimes it's unnecessary, or it makes the character, it just simplifies the character in a way that's not complicated. It's just like, oh, okay, you don't have to judge her because she's a virgin. So it's fine. You can, you know what I'm saying? So I get it. I think it is in the genre, it's overused a little bit. But in real life, of course, whatever you need to do in your life, totally. Yeah. Do it.
Yeah. For whatever reasons, they're your reasons. It's your body, your life.
Exactly. So Well, I'm glad you liked the book because it was very, like, I'll tell my opinion. I read it in like 4 hours.
Oh.
So it was just like, I was just like,
I know. Are you a speed reader? Or is this
we know this about her. We know this about her.
I mean, sometimes I'll get into a book and I won't want to put it down. And I'll
this is how I see, this is how I picture Felicia reading a book. Done.
Well,
this is how I read a book. I just stare at the cover until I like see if I can see somebody in the window for like an hour.
Yeah. Well, listen, when I mean, let's just be honest. It wasn't like the highest grade level of reading. Like it was a simple read. It was not, it wasn't thick prose. It was sort of a shorter book. And
there was no footnotes.
It was just a fast read, just like last month. And I enjoyed it so much. It was such a difference from like, oh my gosh, I have to really read every single word here. You know, there is definitely a lack of verisimilitude as far as the time period, you know, in a lot of aspects, the LARPers, the main character.
I did want to ask about that. I feel like someone in the forum say there weren't necessarily LARPers at that time period, but there were these, like the dandies would kind of dress up and there was a lot of fandom with authors, but they didn't really on a regular basis LARP it out. It was more costume party type stuff.
Yeah, I think we had some comments on the forums by people who actually studied the historical period saying that people did go around and like cosplay as Goethe's, you know, Goethe characters. And but it wasn't necessarily cosplaying. It was more like posing in vignettes and things like that. But there, you know, people would literally, you know, Lord, if you think about it, like Mozart and Byron, I mean, those were like the Cumberbatches of their day, right?
Oh, yeah. Byron, so, like, for sure, yeah.
People would faint and from the eroticism of a Byron poem, you know? Mm. So it was definitely a different era in a way. So there are some Regency romances that you can get that are much more true to life. And, you know, like Philippa Gregory, which is amazingly researched romance.
I love her.
This was not back, you guys, but the writing was great, and it was like romance porn in that even without the actual sex, the romance was the porn of it. Like, oh, they looked at each other, his chest was heaving, like all it was just like, whoa, this is like being thrown. There's a lot of treacle in my face right now, but it was great.
So oh, anyway, is there a treacle tart reference? Did I miss
that? Yeah. That's my thing. Okay, Veronica, what did you think of the book?
I didn't finish.
Sorry,
but I really, really, I'm having fun with it. I think it's a lot of fun, and I liked, you know, as someone who has raised guide dogs, I kind of liked the perspective of a blind lead, and especially since he had his dog friend, and I thought that was an interesting, you know, an interesting point of view that I've never gotten before in a book, I think ever. So I thought that was really, really cool. And I picked a line out of it that I thought was kind of funny. Sometimes I highlight things that I like. This was definitely not his first go at lady tossing. Like potato sacks her in like the one of the first scenes, and I just thought that was funny. But yeah, I do intend to finish. I've got a little more ways to go, but I thought it was a new, interesting perspective. I thought the humor was really good. I thought it was very sweet. I don't really know because I haven't gotten very far yet. You know, she seems like a pretty, you know, she's probably attractive, but not like, you know, a total stunner by that definition of the time. But in his mind, he's just so like, oh my God, like she must be like the most gorgeous woman, like her smell and the way she feels and like the way, like he can see like the light, like shining off her hair and like this brief instant in this moment that he can kind of see a little bit at one time of day. And I just thought it was very romantic in a lot of ways. Like the things that you find attractive about a person that go into your overall perception of how you feel about them. I think when you remove a sense like that, like sight, you all those other things become so heightened, and it makes you appreciate those other things a lot more too.
I always kept picturing when he was describing her because she has crazy big curly dark hair. But like the equivalent of that was like Sarah Jessica Parker. You know, like if you look at her face, like she's not perfect, but she is beautiful. And her hair is like the outstanding thing that kind of escorts her into overall beauty. And that's how I always felt like about this, because people judge would judge her maybe in that time as not being traditionally gorgeous because she doesn't have petite, tiny, you know, delicate features. But like overall, and I thought that was beautiful too, that he, even though he could see a little bit, but he couldn't see a lot, but her overall spirit mm-hmm. of everything yeah. was what made him fall in love with her, which I thought was a really, really cool
But the fact that she had like disco hair, like I know that they were, I think one part of the book says it's like having a black octopus on top of her head or something.
Yes.
And I kept thinking of her hair like Juliana Margulies from The Good Wife.
Oh my God, don't even, you know.
Like her hair, you know, like, by the way, well, I know, I'm obsessed with Good Wife too, Kyla.
You know,
like,
you
and I could do a Good Wife like podcast, I think, just for dinner.
We actually should probably do.
She wears a wig in The Good Wife. She doesn't, because that hair in The Good Wife is all like flat.
That wig is $20,000.
What? Yeah. Holy crap.
I thought they chemically
no.
like enhanced. I thought no. they chemically like nope. you know did the,
no.
the straightening and then
no.
Like with a flat iron and
no. that's
one of the best wigs I've ever seen.
Yeah.
But then I read somewhere that it's a $20,000 wig.
Yeah.
That explains why sometimes it was cute and
yeah.
sometimes I was like, what's going on there?
And there's multiple wigs. There's not just the one. But I love her hair, like when she was on ER. When she had just like the crazy, like just the curls, like frozen, but black hair, right? And I love that hair. Like that's my favorite hairstyle. I normally would have that hair myself, but the problem is if I let it go for too long, it doesn't look really pretty. It looks like like one of those troll pencils that, you know, you do that in the troll hair. So I have to put it back like this or else all the screen, you wouldn't even see my bookcase. You would just see hair everywhere. But I liked her description, and I liked the fact that she wasn't like, again, I think we've had this trope in many of our previous books where the lead woman is super gorgeous, like instantly, and everybody's super gorgeous. It's
but
like
she doesn't know it. She's like, oh, me?
I know. Like, it's like that. It's like that bashful cheerleader crap. I hate that. So it's like, I really liked that they're like, her hair is out of control. And she's not like the typical whatever. Like, I really liked that about this character. So,
Kyla, did you already express your opinions? I can't remember.
No.
Express them.
That makes me feel amazing. I feel really good right now.
No, I'm totally out of it. I'm so tired.
No, it's cool. Go. No, you know what? I'm just gonna drink.
No.
I'm gonna drink. I'm going down. No.
Play some piano for us and tell us your feelings.
Okay. Feelings. Okay, first of all, I pictured her hair as, I did think of Juliana Margulies' hair. I did. Because, of course, I binge watched The Good Wife for a long time. Now I'm stuck on Apocalyptic. So, it's not important. I'm watching, I'm about to finish The Path, so nobody,
you, afterwards, you and I have to talk about The Path because I have so many Scientology Easter eggs in that, so I will let you know later. Okay.
Oh my God. Yeah. Okay. We will.
Okay.
So I'm totally into like apocalyptic fiction. I have no idea why. Election. I pictured Minnie Driver.
Minnie Driver has that hair. You're right.
Yeah. Good point.
That would be really good casting. I wonder if that was in the list. I'm going to look.
I didn't even look. So what I loved is their names.
Their names were amazing. So funny.
And I love it. Like, it's just like this dilapidated, has all like, it's like, oh, there's lightning outside. And then like, then scaring this guy, hunky guy shows up and she's just like, oh my God, my vagina's on fire. And he's just like, oh my God, my penis is on fire, which is not necessarily.
Bad feels.
Yeah.
Maybe.
I mean, my penis is really, really hard. I don't know. But then, I love the slow reveal of him being blind.
Mm-hmm, and that was
then,
good.
Yeah, it was really well done.
That was really well done. And then, but then it also kind of made me sad because I was like, oh, he's the only one who finds her beautiful. That's because she's always felt ugly. So that is going to, you know, be kind of like a mind. What the fuck?
We're allowed to swear now.
Nobody pays for anything.
That's kind of a mind fuck. But because you could see kind of things and stuff in it, that's good. But she, I thought she like acquitted herself incredibly well. She's a heroine. She's very strong. You know, she's not going to give up. You know, I love that. I dealt as that guy who was her solicitor. I loved her ferret. And
it's an ermine. Also, Toronto gal left to go do the gifts, guys. So look at Toronto gal 80s Twitter, and she gift us. Yeah.
What?
She left the chat to go gift us.
Did she tag?
I don't. Oh, I see it now. There it is.
Did she tag us?
She's become.
That's my favorite. Oh my god, it's so good.
Why did I just say that? We got it.
I love this.
Somebody put it up.
It's the best thing I've ever seen.
Somebody put it up.
Score gal 80. It's so funny.
I retweeted that.
She's a master of gift-em, for real.
Oh my god. Well, okay, I'll find it in a second when it shows up. Anyways, my whole thing is that I really liked it, and then it went in a whole different direction, which was super interesting. And I loved it. And then I didn't look it up, but I assume that there's going to be other stories in this series with the other goddaughters.
I don't know. That's a good point because
goddaughters. Oh, the other women who got the things.
The other women who got the castles.
The other castles. That's the whole series.
It's set up for a series.
They set that up.
I want to read about every lady with a castle because that's my dream. Set. I want to be that person who gets a castle and is like, I don't have enough money to renovate. I'm living in a hovel. You know, that's what I kind of want to be in this world.
Okay, it's like buying a house in San Francisco. You know,
I love Regency romances. I love, I don't care. I mean, you know, I love Eloisa James, it's my favorite, obviously. And then I love them all. And so anything with like a Duke, I'm just like, okay,
up with Eloisa James. I got it. John Stanton is live in chat for the first time in 3 years. Welcome.
Oh, John.
I liked all these things. Okay, so we had some really good comments about, you know, basically the forum agreed that it was a really light, fun, quick read. The sexy parts were very hot. That is a lot of things that people want to talk about. Before we get to sexy parts, because we usually do that, can we talk about the one thing that irritated me with this book is that basically the plot is that somehow, okay, Ransom gets blinded because his fiance ran away with another man and he dueled with the guy, even though she really did love the other guy. And so he's blind and he's a sad sack and he basically lets everything just go to poop around him. Seemingly the whole castle deteriorates within 6 months or something, guys, or a year. They had a lot of environmental issues to make this place a dump very quickly.
I could believe that because my apartment looks like it's been ransacked and that just like weird homeless people live in it. If I don't like keep up on all the piles of books and magazines and like wrappers and boxes. So I got that. It's just like when you have a castle, there's just more stuff. Oh my God.
Yeah. Basically the lawyer. Okay.
Nothing's happening. It's fine. It's all fine.
Wait, what's going on? What's going on right now?
Jesse's making the same faces, so I don't know what's going on.
It's okay. Just keep talking.
Oh, my God. Are you okay?
We're fine.
Jesse said Veronica's boyfriend.
You look really traumatized, Veronica.
I know. Does this mean Gryffindor's losing?
Is it beautiful? Bases are loaded in the eighth. Two outs, two strikes. I don't know if I'm behind or not.
It's still been nothing. Good for us,
but I don't know if...
I don't know anything you just said.
Did he strike out yet? What happened? What happened, Jesse? Tell me. I have no
clue. Jesse, say what happened.
We didn't get a point.
What happened?
We didn't get anything. It's fine.
Hunter Pence was up with the bases loaded.
Somebody Pence was up with the bases loaded, and then...
He didn't see if it was a strikeout or if he grounded out or what.
He didn't see if it was a strikeout or if he grounded out or what.
See, I thought you said grounded out, and I'm like, wait. And I'm like, wait a minute, there's garroting in baseball? And I'm like, oh, right. You said grounded out, not garroting.
You don't make it to the base, they're just like...
I know.
Assassin's Creed guy, like Ezio, jumps down and just...
I would watch baseball if there was a possibility in baseball that everyone can die in baseball. Jesse, shut up.
I know. I'm like, I can't train to
Jesse, I'm talking. This is our podcast.
We're done. We're done with the Giants.
Okay. Sorry. Continue on.
You get out of jail in 15 more minutes, time. Veronica. We're out in 15. So my question is that at the end, basically Ransom has been like, I'm Broody, and the castle's falling down around me. And it turns out that his lawyers have been selling off his property illegally around his ears the whole book. And so at the end, they come and they try to commit him for some reason. They try to commit him to an insane asylum so he basically could take everything else. Yeah. And then they don't get punished.
Yeah.
And that just pissed me. It just really is just like, come on, guys. You lost your estate.
That bothered me too, because if this had been a Dickens novel, that guy would be in like crappy prison. Like the worst ever prison.
Penis prison. Penary prison.
Yeah.
Yeah, or killed. Yeah. I don't know.
Or killed. I mean, I feel like in this day and age, if you're Bernie Madoff, then you should be able to kill that guy. Like, I feel like if you're going to duel over a girl who doesn't even want you anymore, why can't you duel with the dude who just stole your castle?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's, like, not fair. I mean, because the guys, I mean, like, look, if this was The Good Wife, you'd be like, well, he's blind. He can't read his mail.
I mean, it's true. Honestly, like, I feel like in those days, I would rather duel over real estate than a relationship.
Like, I think it's more justifiable, because here's the thing you learn is that basically his ex-fiance was a fan of her books, Isabel's books, or Isolde's books, our lead woman's books, father's books, which she ended up actually writing, which also came out of nowhere and at the end. It was a little bit abrupt. But so basically she caused the fiance to run away with the person she actually loved. So she kind of screwed Ransom, which I thought was a nice twist, that personal kind of connection there. So, I don't know what to say about it, guys.
Well, what I don't understand is why she was so upset. Since she'd been writing the books, why is she upset that people expected her to be this certain person when she wrote herself as that certain person?
Yeah, it's true. But she was a kid. I think that the explanation was that her dad wrote the books early on, and then he kind of lost his juice, and she took over.
Wait, she took over the books?
Yeah. Oh, Veronica hasn't finished reading the book.
It's fine. No, I totally expected to be spoiled. I'm just like, oh, that's interesting.
Yeah,
but at the end, in the epilogue, she's pregnant and also writing a sequel, which I'm like, is that legal for copyright? Of course, I'm like, I was like, really? She's writing basically in the same world? Because basically her father's nephew or something who hates her got the rights to all the books, and that's why she's destitute and she has to live in this crappy castle.
Right, yeah, yeah. I remember that.
So I was kind of legally nebulous on whether what she was doing was going to be actually kosher.
Yeah, I wish they didn't allow her to do that, especially as a woman.
And Lange said they were always her books. Oh, okay. I thought that she was she wrote them from the start. Sorry, guys. I had the impression that her dad actually did some. She was too young to be taken seriously, so her dad cut it.
That's what I mean. Yeah, That's what I mean. Why is she so upset that
people should go to the law? They should go and like talk to lawyers, because there's some issues that could have been dealt with at the end of this book, rather than her just being like, "I'm so pregnant and I'm writing and everything's great." You know.
By the way, I hate it when our romance. No offense, Kyla, because you're the only one who's actually spawned so far. I really, really hate it when romance books end in pregnancy, because then I'm like,
that's the worst.
Come on, it's like, give some birth control. Like, you don't always have to end.
They have that there.
They didn't they have didn't. That back then.
They had like the
French. They had it. A Cleopatra used rubbers. I'm pretty sure they could figure it out.
It was not that good. Like the average woman had like 6 children and died in childbirth. I mean, it was like it was not great.
I know. I feel like
they knew about the pull-out method, and they used a French sleeve, I think is what it's called, which is basically a condom.
It's lambskin. It was actually lambskin. But my point, though, again, when she loses her virginity, and he's like, oh, am I hurting you? I'm sorry. But instead of stopping, he just keeps going.
Right.
And it's like,
well, okay, let's talk about the sex scenes, because obviously that was the appeal of this book. I was like, does it have sex scenes? When I went to the Rip Bodice, I was like, I need a Regency romance, but with some racy sex scenes, because we've been through a dry spell the last couple.
I hope you said that really, really loud and people knew who you were.
She knew who I was, and nobody else was in the store because it was at opening. So, but yes, and she was like, oh, I gotcha. So this one was picked specifically for the smut level. And I have to say, there was satisfying smut level, because you're right, Bonnie, in that even though she was a virgin and didn't have a lot of experience sexually, she was all in. She's like, get in me.
Yeah. I mean, in essence, like, she had to get it over with. She had to get it over with, because it's not like if they stopped every time it was sort of painful, she'd still be a virgin. So I'm glad she got it over with. And there were some good sex scenes in this book, I have to admit.
Yeah. I haven't gotten to one yet, so I'm looking forward to that.
There's a comment on the forum that I kind of, I agree with, because, and it's kind of explicit, guys, so hold your ears if you... Shannon P. writes, anyone else feel weird about the fact that Ryan Ransom tupped Izzy in the hallway right before meeting the solicitors and didn't let her fix her hair? I bet she didn't have sexy bedhead. Jessica responds, I wondered about the same scene, except my concern was all the semen this must have been running down her leg. Perhaps that's why women wore all those layers of petticoats and skirts. Yeah.
Nobody ever talks about that.
I know, underwear sometimes. Well, in the medieval times, but I think in this time they wore all the little frilly under things.
Did they wear underwear? I don't think they wore underwear back then, did they?
I think they did then, not in medieval times, but in, like, you know, like with
Edward the Fourth, but then they did.
That would have kept some of it. And then, you know, like, she's got a long skirt on, so.
They probably also had sex towels. Like, not that they probably
in the hallway?
I don't know.
Just in the hallway, you know.
Have them in the hallway.
Don't you keep yours in every room? No,
They had bats. That's Did so she wipe gross. Herself with a bat? Because I don't think that is true.
I don't know.
I'm really sorry I said that. I'm really sorry
I brought it up.
Maybe there's no semen going down her leg. Maybe everything got collected in her womb, and that's why she instantly got pregnant.
Have we gone 5 years without talking about semen running down someone's leg?
I know, it's true.
How?
Because, and it's like, it's everywhere.
No one ever poops. After they go, I mean, listen, there was a BuzzFeed article about...
No one does the post-sex, like, pee to prevent UTI situations.
Yes. Here's where the thing. Die from.
Here's the thing.
Before and after, really, if you want to be real careful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. But here's the thing. I do not want to read a romance book that's got a lot of, like, piss and shit in it, or else I'd read the story of I.
No, but I would like them to say, like, oh, and then I use the necessities. No. You know, like that would be fine.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I had to go out and do my stuff. Yeah.
Just public service announcement. If you don't want to get a bladder infection, go pee-pee after you have intercourse.
Immediately.
Yeah. Because a lot of work. Penises are dirty.
Yeah.
That's not why that happens.
Or
condoms will give you the UTS. A lot of women. Me. Condoms. Every time.
Or,
really?
Every time.
Or if you're into it, just pee on them.
I'm not into that stuff.
Just,
hey, wow. I'm just saying, for some people, that's a thing, and I don't want to leave anybody out in our discussion.
Leave anybody out. Don't.
But see, that's why it's awkward, because if you're like with a new person, you're like, oh, am I going to walk naked to the bathroom and let them see my butt and then go pee, you know, but I need to, but.
I feel like you need like a next to your bed bidet. Yeah, bed bidet.
I don't know if that would be better, because I don't think I would be.
What? It's like a little fountain. It's like you're running through a sprinkler. You're running through a sprinkler, Kyla. Run through the sprinkler.
Really not sanitary.
You have to pee it out. You have to get the
How many viewers have we lost right now?
Many, like 13. Okay, question. We have a couple questions from the forum to get through before we wrap it up and do casting. What do you think of the way, Megan asks, what do you think of the way the relationship between authors and fans played out in the story through Izzy's relationship with her father's fans? How does it relate to current discussions and criticism related to fandom and fan culture? That's a really good question, Megan, because there is a weird... There was a weird dynamic that Ransom kind of tried to put his foot down about, like, Izzy, she is not this character, and stop putting her in a box and making her this naive, sweet character. And she had to play along with it because basically these fans kept her alive. So there was a really an interesting sort of analogy for modern fandom in that people tend to be what other people want from them because people have more access to them and they think they're actually the character they see on screen, which when they might not be. They might be play an innocent person on screen or a nice person on screen. They're really a jerk, or vice versa. They might play an evil guy on screen and everyone thinks they're that evil guy. And in order to sort of keep the fandom going, they play that up, even though they probably might not be. I don't know. What do you guys think?
I feel like if anyone has any say over this topic, it's you, because you're the one that's an actress that's played many different. You've played many different characters, from vampire slayers to hackers to like bisexual hacker. Are you? Well, you know, you're not bisexual on Supernatural, are you?
No, I'm gay. I was a lesbian.
So you're a lesbian hacker on Supernatural, and then you've played all these other types of characters. Do you find, as an actress, that when fans come up to you, and you can say this in a nice way, I don't want to put you on the spot, but when a fan comes up to you and knows you for a certain role, do you feel sort of weird and obligated to feel like you should kind of act a little like them, or do you just act like yourself?
I don't think so. I mean, I think the roles that people know me most for are most similar to me as a person, and since I'm more of a I kind of bridge a personality as well, because people know me as myself more than some actors. Like, you don't really know who Ed Norton is in person. I mean, or like, you know, Sean Bean. I mean, the actors, they keep their personality very separate. I guess maybe celebrity is getting to that point where people know them as people as well. But I was kind of one of the, you know, I was on the cusp because I was on the internet a lot earlier. And so, I mean, I'm very transparently who I am, and people who offer me roles in shows that I love, it tended to be closer to my personality. So I don't feel like I have to put up a facade. I'm very careful just to be considerate to everybody I meet, because I know that might be the only time we're ever interacting. And I know that that's very important in their world, because that's a very small sliver of time from their perspective. So that's the only thing I think I'm careful about. But otherwise, I'm just the person I am in almost all my roles, and they're different, but they're various aspects of me. So
but also,
I think it'd be harder if you're a bad guy or something.
You're also playing characters, where I talked to Will about this, when Will's playing evil Will Wheaton.
Yeah,
Big
that's
Bang
even
Theory,
worse for him. Yeah. Right?
Or it's Seth Green, where he plays, you know, jerkwad Seth Green on Entourage, or something where they're playing themselves, but a jerk version of themselves. And then their fans are like, oh my God, are they jerks in real life? Like, a lot of people can't separate reality from fiction, and so it's interesting. I'm like, I'm reading a lot of, like, is it Mara Wilson that has the memoir that's
out? I need to read her book. I hear it's really great,
and it's really good, because she talks about, as a child star, how people typecasted her as the certain type, and then when she matured, people were really horrible to her because she hit puberty. So I feel like when I was reading this book, I was kind of envisioning what Mara was going through in real life. Whereas you have this role that people want to put you in, and you're not allowed to be yourself in real life.
Yeah. Or you deify people who really are not maybe the best people. Mm-hmm. Bill Cosby. Anyway. Let's get through a couple of the questions in new casting so Veronica can go watch this game thing. What features does your dream castle have? Dungeons, passageways, moat? Okay.
All of it.
Definitely not bats.
No bats?
No bats.
Oh, that was a creepy bats. Scene. I love bats. I think bats are cute.
I like bats as like a bat. I like a bat. Like a singular bat. Like, those are adorable. But like when there's like hundreds or maybe thousands of bats.
But if you have hundreds and thousands of bats, that means you won't have mosquitoes in your moat.
Oh, God.
I want a larder too.
What's that?
I don't know what it is, but somewhere you put food, but it's a walk-in.
Oh, yeah.
It's cool. It's like a walk-in, now where it's colder.
But then I have an escape hatch, kind of like a
butter cheese.
Yeah.
Because then every time I went in, I would imagine somebody lock me in and kill me. So I would have an escape hatch into my secret passageway at the back of the larder.
Mm-hmm.
So people might think, oh, we got her trapped.
Gotta have it.
Myself out.
Gotta have it.
Yeah, I think of this castle thing a lot when I'm like, when I should be paying attention in meetings and stuff. Like, I will always think, okay, what's in my castle? So I'm definitely for a huge library, a real library, and a secret library full of grimoires that no one knows about. And then I also want a bunch of different kitchens, not just one huge kitchen at like the basis where they always put the kitchen in the castle, but like mini kitchens. And then I want all these secret passageways. And I want a slide that's part of the secret passageway that's a slide. I also want a weapons room that people know about and a secret weapons room no one knows about so I can still get weapons just in case.
Bonnie, do you play Minecraft? Because
and I want a space observatory at the top. Because I really think that in that day, I think they still had telescope-esque.
You're going to have to use a lot of cheat codes for that one. Kyla, what do you want in your castle?
Oh my God, in my castle. Oh, I want an amazing bed. I want amazing scenery, but you know what else I want? I want like this, like I've ended up in this world. So my maid takes me to the bathroom where the bath is. I mean, we don't, the toilet is in a whole other room and that's fine. I deal with that on my own. But the bath is like a Roman bath, and then the dude who is probably, who is it this time? maybe James McAvoy or...
Wait, is this like a dude that's in a relationship, or are we talking bath butler?
No, I'm talking like a dude that's like part of like the, he's like a knight or something.
Oh, okay.
And he's like in charge of like keeping an eye on me because they don't know where I'm from or what I'm going to do. And so he accidentally comes upon me while I go into the Roman bath.
Right. But not on the toilet.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
A fantasy versus a real estate plan.
Yeah. Kyla, about like an incident, not like actual decorating.
Okay, well, I want a big room that's maybe like kind of round with big giant windows and a balcony, and then I want it to be like on the ocean, and it's like but rocky ocean, like Ireland or England or somewhere.
Yeah.
And then in the castle, I also want there to be I want a secret door, if not two, in my room, and I would like secret weapons in the floor as well as under my bed. You know, like I want all of those things.
Yeah.
I also want the larder for like when I'm at the masquerade and I can't take it anymore because people are being kind of weird and shitty because they don't know who I am and I'm all special. And so I go into the larder and then like the dude that's hot like follows me in there. And then the other guy, he follows me in there because he wants to protect me. And then there's like another guy.
We're going back to incidences.
I'm sorry.
Jesus. So you're getting seduced. You're going to get butter in your hoo-ha if you don't be careful.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hang out in the larder. That's what I want. That's my castle.
I feel like
I want a menagerie. Nobody asked me.
I'm going to ask you. What do you want, Veronica? And then we'll move on to casting.
An exotic animal menagerie.
Would you feed them yourself or would you have a staff?
I'd have a staff, but I would spend a lot of quality time with them.
Would you have an aviary or a butterfly room?
I'd like to have a butterfly room.
I would like to have a butterfly room as well.
But you can't mix a menagerie in the butterfly room. That seems
dangerous. No, obviously the birds would eat all the butterflies.
Yeah, or obviously.
The kittens it would be adorable and then all the butterflies would be dead. It would be bad.
I don't know. I feel like you could have a broken butterfly wing room.
No.
Oh, that's depressing.
Room.
That's a really sad. I don't like animal heads at all. Fake ones.
I need a whole taxidermy room.
No,
you can't come into my menagerie and make all my animals into your taxidermy room.
Just because I like taxidermy does not mean I go around killing everyone's animals.
That is your room.
I don't trust it.
I will only have taxidermy of animals that committed suicide. There, do you feel better?
That's really
or assisted suicide.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, let's do casting and then we'll wrap it up, guys. So okay. We had a lot of suggestions. I definitely said a dark-haired Sarah Jessica Parker for Izzy. And then Fassbender for Ransom, only because his skull looks very heavy as a human. And I could see him playing blind very well. I don't know.
His skull is very heavy.
Doesn't it look like if you acid washed his skull, it would be heavier than normal people's?
You just turned in Fassbender into Ghost Rider in like 3 seconds. Like now I think of Fassbender without skin on his face.
I think he's hot. I'm just saying his head looks heavier, like skull boss.
That might be my favorite sound that anyone's ever made on this show.
Oh God.
All right, anybody have cat? We got okay. Anybody else have castings? And then I'll read a couple of them and then we're going to be out.
I guess for the main, it was either going to be Juliana Margulies or how
she's
old
too
was
old.
I know,
she's
I know, like
old.
A young one, like a young Juliana Margulies from like the beginning of ER.
She still looks good though.
From the beginning of ER. Great. Or I would say Emma Stone with black kinky hair.
Okay. And what about any other, what about Ransom? Any suggestions?
Well, I was going Fassbender route, but now it's like skinless Fassbender. I can't do that to the dude.
I can. The guy from the North and South. You know, that guy?
I got
Patrick Swayze. Oh, no, Armitage. No. Richard Armitage.
Oh, okay, yeah. That's a good one. And then yeah, what about Izzy, though, Kyla?
Yeah.
Oh, well, still, I was thinking of, you know, Minnie Driver, but I don't know. I just felt like it could be, like, anybody that was really tall and God,
the sports,
awesome.
The sports, they, I don't know what's going on. It's not good.
I know. I'm pretending that Veronica really hates Minnie Driver.
Yeah. No, that was a good sound. That was a happy sound.
I was going to say a young Juliana Margulies because I love that show, and so I just think she's gorgeous.
Minnie Driver was a good one. Minnie Driver was an excellent suggestion.
You can also say like Emma Watson when she was at Hermione because she had that hair that was all over the place in Harry Potter.
No. She needed to be bigger than that and taller and stuff.
Okay,
so.
I'm just saying on the
forums, Amelia Clark, Sarah Z. Ronan, Carrie Mulligan, Emma Watson, Felicity Jones, Tatiana Maslany.
They're still all short.
I know. Ransom, Charlie Hunan, and Chris Pine, and Gerard Butler. That's a really good one.
Oh, yeah, Gerard.
Gerard Butler.
Gerard. I feel like he has a decent-sized skull.
I think Ransom has a heavy skull, and that contributed to his sight loss, maybe. I don't know, guys.
Probably. So scientific.
Well, you're a doctor, so you know.
It's true. Okay, so guys, next month's it will be November 1st, which is a week later, but it's close to the end of the month, and it's better because it's right after Halloween, and it's Bonnie's pick. Bonnie, do you want to yell out what your book is?
I don't have it in front of me, but I think it's called
Iron and Velvet by Alexis Hall. It's paranormal. Ooh. It's a number one in a series. It's a female-female romance.
Yes.
And it has vampires. And the reviews were interesting on Goodreads. Very mixed, but I'm excited about it.
And because we had such good luck with Ripped Bodice this time around, Ripped Bodice suggested this
yeah. Well, and then the alt, every month our forum picks the alt, and they have picked some awesome ones. Broken Dolls is the forum pick, and it doesn't look like a romance, but it looks like an amazing book, you guys. It's about a doll who's alive in an attic, and it looks creepy. So,
I'm totally going to read that.
Yeah, I just bought this book, so I'm going to be reading along the alt. And you guys, go to the forum, goodreads.com/vaginalfantasy.
I just heard...
Oh. Something
I just heard count. I think we maybe got a point. Maybe something happened. My husband. Yes. I think we got a point.
He's jumping up and down. I'm sorry.
We got a 3-run homer. I think.
I've never been that excited about anything.
I know, Felicia. I was just thinking that. I was like, when's the last
time? I don't know for sure what's happening.
Okay, go do it. Leave. Just leave. Monica, we're done. Get off camera.
Okay. I love you. Okay. Bye. I gotta go. Bye.
Just get out.
Oh my God.
I've never seen her excited about that, and I've never been that excited.
Me neither. I was trying to think the last time I was that excited. I think it's when they cast Cumberbatch as Doctor Strange.
Yeah. Oh my God.
I just see you next month. I don't care, but it's nice to see them excited.
Yeah.
That was like, that was almost pornographic and exciting.
I know, that was very sexual. If I ever pictured Veronica's O face, that was it.
Oh God, stop it. I'm scarred.
No, I don't know.
Just saying.
All right. Thanks, you guys. Join the forums, join a local group, or just read a book with us, or just be lost and watch us drink and be stupid every month. So see you later. Bye.
Bye. Love you all. Bye.